Welcome to Fading Memories, a podcast with advice, wisdom, and hope from caregivers who have lived the experience and survived to tell the tale. Think of us as your caregiver best friend.
With me today is Ed Park. He is the founder and creator of NeuroReserve. They have a product called Relevate that is designed to help fill the nutritional gaps in our diets, specifically designed to help our brains. I hope I said that all correctly, especially since I take Relevate.
That's good. Thanks for,
oh, good. It's like, as soon as I start talking, I'm like, wait a minute, am I saying this right? Obviously, Relevate's working because my brain remembered all of the details with no cheat sheet. So thanks for joining us, Ed.
Thanks. Thank you. You have three generations of women in your family that have had Alzheimer's dementia, memory loss. So, you know, I'm sure, and you really know about this. And so it's just great to meet you. And we had in our first conversation, which was just super great to meet you. Now we're doing this podcast now, but like, it was just really nice to meet you. And obviously the people who are listening probably really, really care about, you know, obviously the people that are caring for and also their brains as well. So thanks. Thanks
Thank
for having
you.
Me on.
Well, you're welcome. So it's, to me, it's very important. I mean, caregiving is so emotionally, physically, and financially, not that you're helping on that part, but it's so draining. And everything that goes with caregiving, to me, and I felt this personally, it's just not great for your brain. And it's very difficult to do all of the things that are suggested. The meditation, the sleep right, to get the exercise, get outside, eat right. It's like, that's a whole process in itself. And then you're trying to take care of somebody else, even for somebody that's maybe taking care of a young child. That's a lot of steps and things to go through. It's a lot of steps that I'm just taking care of myself pretty much. So
yeah.
I was really excited that you guys approached me to tell me about NeuroReserve and Relevate. But let's start with your story, because I know that, you know, most of the people that I talk to, they don't just wake up one day and say, I'm going to come up with this thing for brain health. There's usually a backstory. So why don't you tell us the backstory?
Yeah. So, I mean, the backstory primarily is about my family. And so I have a family history like you of neurodegenerative disease. In my case, it was my father who was diagnosed at the age of 48, 49, that time period, with Parkinson's disease. For a lot of your listeners probably understand that Parkinson's and Alzheimer's have a lot of crossover between the two and their pathologies. And but then later on, what happens to many people with Parkinson's is they end up with Lewy body dementia. And so that's also what my father suffered from in the last maybe 5-7 years. He had Parkinson's and then later Lewy body dementia for about 19 years. And so he was diagnosed when I was like maybe a teenager. Well, not maybe, I was. So I was a young teenager. I didn't really know how to process that very well, quite frankly. And then you know, high school happens, college happens, and dad was doing okay, but then after college, and that's when the dementia started setting in. And for, you know, Lewy body dementia is a little different from Alzheimer's type dementia. There are major hallucinations involved with it. So it's very psychopathological, right? So you're detached from reality and you start to see things that aren't there, hear things that aren't there. And it's very real. It is straight up real. You know, my father would people would be looking into our house from the outside the windows, things like that, and they'd be there. I mean, and there'd be people in our attic, and he'd be trying to get them out or trying to flush them out, you know, and newspapers all over the windows to make sure nobody would come in or look inside. I mean, it's a very detached type of situation. And so my mother really took the brunt, right? So when it comes to caregiving, my mother took the brunt of it. She took care of him. And there was a, you know, obviously like most caregivers, right? There's a point at which, you know, she couldn't leave the house anymore. She couldn't even go to the grocery store because of what might happen while she's gone. And obviously mobility was very difficult for my father later on, also because of the movement disorder associated with Parkinson's disease, right? So she really, really, she was just an amazing caregiver through that time. And so, but obviously it impacted the whole family. So we were back and forth and things like that. I have two sisters and all three of us were all back and forth in the house, you know, various times and points, you know, whether or not, you know, my father was in acute care, you know, or not, you know, if there's an episode like that. So that left a big, mark on my psyche, you know, obviously going through the rest of my life, completely hypersensitive about every little thing that happens to me and going to the neurologist, basically saying like, what's wrong with me? I had a twitch and my finger is, you know, and then they do the whole workup and they're like, yeah, just go home. Right. But then I come back and yeah, like I had another, you know, twitch on my eyelid or something like that is, you know, and work me up. But the thing is, funnily enough, I went into pharmaceuticals. So I did about 15, 16 years in pharmaceutical research and development. And there was a time when, you know, actually my most recent time before NeuroReserve, when I was doing nutritional therapeutics for people who are extremely malnourished. These are people who are on tube feeds, things like that. So that gave me a real appreciation for nutrition, actually, and how much of an impact it can make for people. And so that's when kind of that combination of personal experiences and then the professional side, you know, I figured, and I was going through my quasi midlife crisis, you can call it, right? So I had actually gone through, I'm going to just kind of spill a little bit here because I was going through a lot of other medical issues for myself. I hadn't been taking care of myself very well at all. And there are a lot of things that caught up with me, you know, about 5 years ago, a lot of things that caught up with me. And that forced me to really think about my mortality and my, you know, what am I doing to my body? How am I really treating it? Am I treating it the right way? Am I treating myself the right way? And that then kind of brought together all of those personal professional experiences. And I finally said, you know what? Nutrition can make a big difference. It's made a big difference in my life. And now what can I do? And that was a genesis of NeuroReserve. What can I do on the nutritional side or brain health? This, which is something that I really didn't want to think about because even though I'd run to the neurologist like a lot, I also at the same time would not want to learn about neurology and nutrition because, or neurology in general, because I don't want to find out my risk, right? So some people out there who are listening, they might be thinking the same thing, right? I don't even want to find out. I don't even want to know, you know, what my risk is. Now, that was very much me until about 4 or 5 years ago. And at that point, I just finally said, okay, I'm going to see if there's anything that can be done about preventive health and for neurodegenerative diseases like Alzheimer's, like Parkinson's, Lewy body. And it turns out there is. So when I started looking at the medicine and the science and where it's at, nutrition ends up being a really big lever. And you mentioned a lot, you know, we're speaking right before you press record here, right? But you were speaking about all these things that people should be doing, right? And nutrition is one of those big ones. And I learned that just 5 years ago. You know, I was like, wow, I can actually do something to protect my brain health. Oh, wow, I actually have control, some level of control over my brain fate, right? And that was huge to me. And the thing is, when I looked at the landscape, there is a lot of great research going on the pharmaceutical side for treatment after a person is diagnosed, right? After they get to the point where they're showing symptoms of neurodegenerative disorder. On the nutrition side, there really wasn't much that I saw when I was kind of like looking for nutritional things, you know, like I was improving my diet, but at the same time, I wanted to find like nutritional products and supplements, things like that to help plug gaps. I saw a lot of these like brain products that were very kind of short term or kind of like it's legal Adderall or it's like a limitless pill, or it's like going to give you a boost. It's like a 5-hour energy drink type thing that's going to give you that boost for the next sales call you're going to do, or the next, software coding you're going to do. It's kind of very much peak performance type stuff. And I didn't really see anything that spoke to my own family experience and actually many other people's family experience, because I know my story is not unique whatsoever, right? And so about long-term brain health, about lifelong brain health. So that was a genesis of NeuroReserve. That's a really long-winded kind of rigmarole, right, that I've just gone through. But that was the genesis of NeuroReserve. And that's what made me realize, okay, maybe we can do something here in the nutrition space for preventive health for the brain and do it in a really genuine way. Do it in a way that tells people this is where we're at. We don't know everything, to give people some confidence that this is the best we can do right now to plug some of those gaps, like you described earlier.
I backed into daily supplements, literally like backed into it. I live in I live in the suburbs of San Francisco, far-flung suburbs. So I can't get too much further and still be in the Bay Area. And so it's a very much still an agricultural town. We grow corn and cherries and walnuts and almonds, other things. Corn and cherries and the nuts are key. They're the main crop. And back in the before times when I used to drive to the gym, there's a field where 1 year, I think it's even years is corn and odd years is tomatoes. Doesn't really matter if I get that right, but they swap back and forth the crop because that's obviously good agricultural management. Because if you just plant corn there every year, eventually you're going to deplete the nutrients in the soil. I'm not super excited about when I'm out with our cycling club and I'm riding my bike and the crop duster flies by and it's like, blah.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
Fortunately, we don't have that terribly often. I think I've experienced it twice in the last decade, close to a decade. And I went from late 30s, very seriously overweight. Most of my listeners know I've told this story a zillion times. It's not Alzheimer's. It's just fact. I had a photography client who was a doctor. She said, you're overweight. You have a family history of diabetes. You're screwed. And by saying the term, you're screwed, fired up the competitive nature in me. And I was like, I'll show you. I mean, I've never even seen this lady since. So unless she somehow fell on this podcast, she has no clue that I lost 100 pounds. Kept that off I kept 90 of it off for a long time. And now I got to work on some 30 that have come on with menopause, caregiving, pandemic, but we're working on it. And my husband had a medical situation. He had blood clots in his lungs again. And so now he has to be on blood thinners the rest of his life. They don't know what's causing them, which is frustrating because both of us like to know, like, why give me the reason why so that I can find the answers and move forward. So not knowing why is very frustrating, but he knows what he needs to do. And so he's now doing it. So that's also helping my weight loss. But I went on the health kick journey so that I would not end up with diabetes and then learned that that was good for my brain health. So, but
yes,
for the supplements, somewhere along the line, I read that our modern agricultural corporations, it's like the soil isn't as rich as it was 100 years ago. So even if they rotate the crops and, well, I guess the crop dusting is probably a poison, but, you know, and fertilize it. I don't know. One of these days I'll have to drive by and see what they do to amend the soil. They must do that in the winter because they do stuff all winter long too. And it's like frustrating because they blow dust all over the road. As soon as you wash your car, you drive past the farm and it's like, well, now my car is filthy again. But that's when I realized, because I could see modern farming and I could tell, I'm like, that dirt's not black. So it's not as rich in nutrients as maybe it was 100 years ago or 150 years ago when they started growing corn in this town. And that's when I'm like, maybe I should take a daily vitamin or some supplements to kind of enhance what I'm not getting, even though I eat really healthy now, but I'm not getting the nutrients because it's not getting into the food.
Yeah, that's a big problem. I mean, I think one of the poster child of that sort of like nutrient depletion from soil is magnesium. It is a big problem with how much it's depleted. So therefore, lots of foods that should have magnesium, lots of like these greens and things like that, don't typically have as much anymore. So. So, I mean, a lot of fixes need to be made in our, commercial agriculture, at some point we're going to reach the red line, right? And it's going to be like, there's nothing in this food, and eventually we'll do something about it. I think right now we're still at that point where we kind of move along with it. You know, obviously there's organic and a crop rotation, things like that, you know, at a smaller scale, nowadays, you know, and you could find that at like some very expensive grocery stores and things like that. But otherwise, nutrient depletion is a big issue that's starting to make its way around the entire world. So,
I'm in California. We produce 60% of the crops for this country. So you guys might want to slow. You're in Nevada. You don't got water to share. So,
we need water to share.
Yeah.
And we're probably our number one source of food, right? So
I do know that they ship our corn across the country and across the world. So I had a brief Instagram back and forth commentary, and I'm going to poke them again. but a care home, I think it was a care home in Iowa, which is where my dad is from. They're like, oh, we love our Iowa corn. And I'm like, let's have a corn off.
Yeah, a corn off.
You ship me some of yours and I'll ship you some of ours. And we'll do an Instagram live where we sample. And because I think that'd be fun, especially because my dad was from Iowa. So I'd be interested to know what it, like, does it taste different? Because ours is a sweet white corn, which is
I love that. Yes.
It's probably not the best thing to eat because it's real sweet.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I'm sure the natural sugars in the corn are high because it's really good. And you have, and we just got, we're late to the party. We got a Instapot, so the pressure cooker. We got it for our road trip that we're taking soon. And it's amazing how great the corn is out of the Instapot. Like, I've done it boiled and I've done it on the grill. I've done it all kinds of ways. And it's like, okay, this pressure cooker is really, really good because it really infuses the flavors. I know we're going to make everybody hungry.
Does it? Yeah, because I think of, you know, we have an Instapot too. And I usually just think of it as a way to make really, really tender meat really fast.
Yeah.
Like, that's what my wife always roasts, like chicken in there with all these spices and stuff. And all of a sudden, boom, you get this like super tender, juicy chicken, you know, right out of it, like in 40 minutes only. It's like, yes.
Yeah, that was the first thing we made was a Tex-Mex chicken for taco salads because the meat was so infused with flavor. And I'm just going to tell you guys now, Ed and I are recording like about lunchtime. So,
oh yeah. Yeah. That's
so I think subconsciously we must be getting hungry because we're talking about food.
Yeah. I'm just nursing my morning coffee still. So yeah, we're getting there.
It's now I got to figure out what to have for lunch. Cause now food is on my brain, but let's see, where do I want to go with this one? So we know we've discussed a little bit about why we need to supplement our nutrition. You know, even if you eat organic and vegan and all of that great stuff, we're still missing out on nutrients, right?
Typically, yes. I mean, you know, there's when you look at how when we our first product is obvious, it's on the market now, right? We launched earlier this year, and our first product's called Relevate, and it's meant to help people mimic the intake of really, really nice overachievers in brain health, right? The people who live the longest with the healthiest brains, people along the Mediterranean, people in these kind of blue zones, you know, things like that. So we wanted to make a supplement that matches those overachievers for brain health. And when you look at how they eat compared to, say, the standard US or North American diet, the North American diet is profoundly deficient in a few different types of very brain healthy foods, particularly dark green leafy vegetables. That's just one of those things that we're up to in some cases like 90%, you know, deficient, you know. So I mean there's it's meaning not 90% of people are deficient, and the deficiency can be as severe as up to 70%, right? So it's you know, it's and that's just one. The other is in you know, specific types of fruits that are very healthy for the brain, like berries, dark pigmented berries, because the pigments that make them so pretty are also very protective as well. So there's berries are not a big thing actually, even though lots of strawberries I know are grown in California, which I love. Lots of other berries actually. The consumption in the United States of berries is actually quite low, and hopefully we'll get to a point where we're having more berries. So there's elements and obviously nuts. So nuts are extremely important for certain fatty acids and also for minerals. So and metals. And we were talking about magnesium earlier, you know, so many other minerals that they soak up and they become really high, you know, rich and abundant sources of. So before I learned much about brain health and nutrition, I did not eat many nuts. I was not a nut guy. I was just so not. Now I'm like eating as many nuts as I can. Thankfully, Costco has like, you know, big old bags, you know. So eating a lot more of that. But still, even then, I did this test, and I think people should go here. It's a place called healthybrains.org. So it's the Cleveland Clinic's brain assessment or brain health assessment website. It's called healthybrains.org. And there's a brain health index, a BHI, that they've developed. And you can assess yourself in six different dimensions. And And like you said, Jen, you mentioned a lot of them, right? You know, one of them is nutrition, and you can assess how well you're doing there. And even for myself, I'm gluten-free now. I watched my carb intake and obviously I upped all these things. I did my like brain health index for nutrition, and I ended up still underneath 50% out of a score of 100. So, or 50 points out of a score of 100. I ended up like, I think it was like 38 or something. It was really bad. I feel like I've improved my diet a lot, having fish like twice a week, so forth. I know you don't like fish, right, James?
When we had our get to know you chat, I do recall saying that if you told me that if I ate fish 3 times a week, I'd never get Alzheimer's, I still probably, and then I paused, I'm like, no, I'd probably gag it down, but I wouldn't like it. And I have tried fish in... I don't eat anything fried because that's just horrible for you. But it still doesn't taste good fried. Like, you know, even like the most destructive way of cooking it, I don't know what it is, because we live right on the Delta and people fish in the Delta, although I don't really think that's a great idea. High salt, salinity in the water, and just, oh, no, thank you. I don't think it's, no. But one interesting thing is, as I've gotten older, so in the last 2 years, maybe, I have really lost my taste for beef. And my husband is actually getting into vegetarian meals. Yes. We won't go full vegetarian. I know that. I just know the two of us. But eating less red meat is helpful. And I was going to ask you a quick question because do you know which nut is highest in magnesium?
So nuts that are high in magnesium, I believe it's almonds. So almonds are pretty rich in magnesium.
We grow those here.
Almond, I think California is like a huge almond state, right?
Yeah, so. It is. The town next door to me is like grapevines and almond trees and suburban housing so that you can commute somewhere else. That's where I live. It's like, we've got agricultural and a bedroom community that people generally until last year commuted out of. I don't know what's happening now. I can't keep track of the rest of the world, but have you ever seen how they harvest walnuts and almonds?
No, because I imagine it's really intensive having to break through the shell, or the walnuts at least.
Well, how they get them off the tree?
Oh, no. No.
Oh, it's fascinating. And I learned this story from my dad, but also living here, I get to observe it. They basically strap a big rubber belt around the trunk of the tree, and they shake the crap out of the tree, and all the nuts fall out of the tree. My uncles used to do that, I think by hand. I have to ask the uncles, but I don't think they had a machine back in the 60s. But yeah, nowadays, like probably late summer, early fall, you'll drive by the almond fields and or the walnut trees, and you know, there's like, I don't know. It's like a gas powered machine. It just basically shakes the crap out of the trees. It's really fascinating. Yeah. And they usually put like tarps underneath them to catch them. But then there's people that got to clean them up. And then I don't know, they go to a processor after that, I assume, because we don't process anything other than the corn, because it doesn't need much. Like if the company in Iowa will take me up on my corn off, I can go over to GNS Farms and get stuff that was picked at like 3:30 this morning and ship it to them. We actually took corn. Well, I should back up. Most of my listeners know that my husband and I are Rotarians. Our club we did work with a club in India. We helped fund, and it's complicated, so I'm not going to get into how we initiated basically $250,000 to set up two of their hospital surgery, the operating rooms. Wow. This is Mother Teresa's hospital, and like 60% of the patients they see are like dirt poor, and they had like one hospital out of hospital operating room. There we go. I keep using the wrong word. Operating theater out of four that was functional, which obviously is not great. And through the magic of donations and matching funds and everything, we basically gave them $250,000 in medical equipment, which I've always said, I don't think that would flush out an entire operating room in the state. So I kind of wonder about that one sometimes. But in 2018, when we were in the convention, this is the last Rotary convention we got to go to, the gentlemen from that club were at that convention. So my husband literally got corn from the farm that's not very far from me that was picked in the middle of the night. And he said, how do I get this from here to Toronto safely? And they said, well, take it on board. And it was literally wrapped in a wet towel in a bag. And we transported this stupid corn across the country into Canada. And then at the convention, we gave it to the guys from India. It's like, here is corn from Brentwood. You could, and then he was so excited. I'm like, this is the most inane thing.
These are gifts to just, you.
Yeah, I'm like, couldn't we have shipped them a carton or something? This is very strange. But yeah, so agriculture is like kind of like in the background of my life around here. So I didn't know how many people knew that you...
Pumpkin seeds. I just thought of pumpkin seeds are really high in magnesium.
Oh, I like pumpkin seeds. I try to eat some nuts, but I learned through my weight loss journey that my body is real good at hanging on to fat. And the only way I lost all the weight was to go super low fat, and which meant egg whites, no whole egg. I mean, it was a little nuts. And we're not going back that way. I hope I don't have to go back that way, because it was so low fat for 2 years that I wonder if I did a disservice to my brain health, because I wasn't getting the nuts, the egg yolks. You know, we were eating only lean meat, which is good. Now
that's good. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But now the eggs came back, full eggs came back. I do eat some nuts, but I'm one of those people.
Good. Yeah. Cause the eggs have choline, you know, the yolks, you know, they have choline in it. Very important for brain. And of course they're the healthy fats. I mean, those long chain polyunsaturated fatty acids like DHA, you know, the omega-3s from fish oils, you know, those are very important.
I take those too. So. Oh no, although the krill oil, now that I take Relevate, I don't have to take the krill oil.
Yeah, you have a really, really nice substitute now. So
yeah, which is good, because it's like the little pill container that we had for all of our supplements, because I don't take any actual medications, just supplements. Mine was kind of overflowing, so I emailed your assistant and I said, how many of these other things can I stop taking now? Which is kind of helpful. But I do, and the other reason that I knew supplements actually were beneficial is, what are we talking about? So 3 years ago, we also have a local health hut, sells vitamins, supplements, all kinds of stuff. And I was just, my energy level was not great. And okay, I was 49. So we all know like time of life for women at that point. So I went to the health hut. Yep. I said, okay, so here's what's going on with me. I have like my energy level's not great. And they interrupted me and they popped this bottle on the counter. This, you need this. It was run by two ladies. And I said, don't you want to know what else is going on? They're like, nope, you need this. It's menopause complex. And I've been taking it since June of 2019, or was it 2017? Like 3 or 4 years. So I don't get all of the menopausal issues. I don't have hot flashes. I do get warm ones, but I don't have like disruptive stuff happening that most women do. So I'm like, and I've read like, oh, these menopause things, these supplements, they don't work. I'm like, yes, they do. Because if I don't take one, if I miss a day, day two, it's like, okay, burn it up. Where's my sleep? So I know they work, or at least, you know, they're psychosomatically working. I literally went from, I didn't think that vitamins and supplements were beneficial. I was in the camp of, you take them and they just get flushed eventually, to, yes, they do work, and there's reasons we should take them. So that's one of the reasons.
It's interesting, because a lot of the medical advisors in the company, when I first approached them, you know, there are various, you know, research institutions. And when I asked them about, well, how do you feel about helping out with a nutrition, you know, supplement company for brain health? And obviously there's a healthy skepticism there, right? You know, when they heard it out and they said, okay, we're going to base this on evidence-backed brain protective diets. Okay, this makes sense. And they said, this is good, because it is really hard for people to change. I mean, first of all, okay, I want to say this, you know, we don't we don't want to advocate that supplements are a replacement for a healthy diet, right? They're not going to be a replacement for it. What they are is a tool. They're yet another nutritional tool that we can use to help protect our brains, right? And when we think of it that way, is that they're part of a larger toolkit that includes exercise and, you know, obviously, you know, cognitive training and things like that, then it makes sense, right? And it's just very hard for people to change. That's the thing that the physicians were telling me. They see patients every day. They see their family members every day. And even when they make small changes in their diet or in their daily regimen that they do, whether or not it be exercise or not, it's a huge deal. But a lot of times, that either for practical reasons or for stubbornness reasons or whatever it might be, that people are limited, you know, and so that's the reason why supplements, you know, for people like myself and others, can make quite a bit of sense. So, I totally hear you on that, you know, and you can see them make, you know, you can feel them making a difference. And as long as you understand why they're designed the way they're designed, then you can have confidence that they're going to provide benefits and so forth. So.
It's just been an interesting journey from, you know, taking a daily vitamin, you know, you basically, it just goes through your system and ends up in the waste treatment plant. And to now I have a routine. My husband puts the supplements in a little bowl that's on the counter. I pick up my water bottle, take the supplements, and then I go do my exercise, which helps get them into my system a little faster.
Oh, I bet.
It's worked for like, occasionally you'll have a headache. I do get a lot of headaches. So I do actually take a supplement for that one too. But there was one time years ago, I was like, oh my God, my head is killing me. And I popped 2 or 3 Tylenol, got in the car, drove to the gym again 4 times. And the music is usually kind of loud at gyms. We all know this. And I was a little hesitant because I'm like, I don't know, you know, up and down and all the exercise and the loud music, this is not going to help my headache. By the time we were through the warm-up, my headache was gone. And I'm like, I think the adrenaline from the exercise jump-started the process of the Tylenol. Because it literally was like 12 minutes from my house to the gym. So it didn't have time to get all the way into my system. Mm-hmm. And I've experienced that several times. So I've learned things over the years. And I hope it's beneficial. I'm not going to stop taking all these supplements to see if I feel differently. I'm just going to have to go on faith that I know the menopause ones work. Because like I said, if I miss one day, it doesn't take very long before all those charming symptoms start popping up. And it's like, yeah, no, we're not doing that. Let's go take this up. And sometimes if they're bad, I'll take 2 because it's 1 to 2. And so we've taken the krill oil. Although, like I said, I don't take that one anymore because it's much easier to just take the Relevate every day. And then I don't have to gag down fish.
So, yeah. Okay. So if you're not into fish, then this might be the way to go, you know, having supplemental, fish oil. And ours is from herring roe. So it's from fish caviar. So herring caviar oil. So
wow.
Sounds pretty fancy. No, but really it's just very, very, it has a very high, abundance of DHA and it's attached to a certain type of molecule that helps carry it into the brain more easily and more efficiently. So there is a difference between the different types of omega-3s out there. You know, some standard fish oils are really good for the heart, right, as we know. And then there are other types, like the type that we put in our product that makes it obviously easier for it to go into the brain. So something that we should pay attention to.
Yeah, all my listeners should know, because we do talk about this fairly regularly, is what's good for your heart is also good for your brain and vice versa. I have a friend retiring soon, his sleep apnea. And so he's been using the CPAP machine and his blood pressure's gone down. And he was talking about the interesting correlation between better sleep and his heart, or his blood pressure going down and other positive aspects of using the machine. And I said, you do know that what's good for your heart is good for your brain. And he's like, no, I'd never heard that. And I'm like, you know me, I'm sure you've heard this, but whatever. And so I basically explained that, you know, the lack of oxygen in his brain puts stress on his heart and his brain. You're not getting enough oxygenated blood to your brain, which is bad for your brain. Blah, blah. So he was like even more excited to use this machine. So I'm always for, I like natural things. And I went from being like, ew, exercise, no, to like literally exercise 6 to 7 days a week and, mm-hmm. you know, walk the dogs, which is not necessarily part of the exercise routine. It's just what they need. So it's all, I feel like we're learning that brain health is more, you know, if you want to avoid Alzheimer's and dementias or Parkinson's disease or any of those ugly things that generally hit at the end of life, but not always. Like you said, your dad was awfully young when he got Parkinson's.
Yeah.
That we need to learn to take better care of ourselves. And that's not, like I said, that's not always easy. It takes time and effort. And sometimes you're just like, oh, forget it. Give me a hamburger.
I know, once in a while, that's fine. No, but there's the mind diet, and I don't know, you know, you might have spoken about this before, you know, on you know, and that's a very powerful diet. You know, it's a diet that can reduce people's risk of Alzheimer's disease by as much as 53%. So that's not a small movement there. That's a big needle mover, you know, as far as risk reduction. So the closer people can stay on it, even if people stay on it moderately, kind of follow it a little bit, but not fully, then they reduce their risk by 35%. So these are really powerful diets. And, you know, that's obviously the reason why we design the way we design our products. But the thing is just pay attention to green leafy vegetables. So everybody, green leafy vegetables, dark green leafy vegetables, right? Like kale and spinach and obviously broccoli, fennel leaves, coriander, whatever you can find, you know, just green leafy vegetables, berries specifically, as mentioned before, focus on the berries, focus on the fish if you're okay with fish, and especially cold water fish. So cold water fish is very important because cold water fish are the ones that are really rich in these brain healthy fats, right? It's because they're in cold water. I mean, they'll completely freeze unless they had a really fluid fatty acid inside of them. And that's the DHA and the EPA. So olive oil, tons of olive oil, whole grains, you know, poultry in moderation. And then the nuts and seeds that we talked about earlier, right? Particularly walnuts and almonds, you know. So I'm trying to go through a list here. Hopefully you can remind your audience of the checklist, right? Beans and especially like black and kidney beans. And those are really important because like you were talking about diabetes earlier, right? But their fiber levels, and when you have beans, lentils, things like that, it slows down digestion and it doesn't give you such a spike, you know, hyperglycemic mm-hmm. spike, you know, that happens, you know, so it slows things down and the wine, red wine in moderation, obviously. So that has a lot of wonderful phytonutrients in it.
Yeah, I don't drink either because wine gives me heartburn. Mm-hmm. I had, was this in 1998, I had bronchitis, and then 6 weeks later got strep throat. And both times the doctors gave me that Z-Pak, so it's like 6 antibiotics versus 30, which is very convenient, but 6 weeks apart, and we had a landlord that was a crook, and I wanted to kill him. And the only reason that I didn't, literally, I hope the FBI is not listening. I didn't kill him, so it's fine. But the only reason that I didn't seriously figure out how to do it was because I had my daughter. She was like six, 7 years old. So I'm like, I don't want to try.
Yeah, life in prison if I get caught. I don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'd miss too much.
Yeah, that was my thought. I'm like, parenting from jail is not my idea of a good time. So we'll skip that. And then considering my mom needed care, it's probably a good thing that I opted not to run him over with my car because that was kind of my plan. But it's like, you know, everybody thinks I'm this nice podcast host, and now that I just let out the evil part. But I just had a realization because I've been taking Relevate for like 6 weeks. And in the past, so my husband had his pulmonary issue over Memorial Day weekend. And so he has cleaned up how he eats, which obviously has benefited me as well. Ugh, tongue's not working. And lately I have noticed that I have had less sugar cravings. And I'm like seriously like the cookie monster when it comes to sugar. So I am going to say it's because of Relevate.
I'm not going to stop you. But, you know,
I mean, I made cookies the other day. I learned how you can take out half of the butter and replace it with silken tofu. It does not change the taste. It changes the texture a little bit, but then if you air fry them, I have like a toaster oven that has an air fry setting, but you can put it in any kind of air fryer. Amazing cookies. I have people that are like, oh my gosh, these are the best cookies ever. And then I tell them I took out half the butter and put in tofu and they're like, what? They're still good. They keep eating them. I literally made cookies. What I do is I freeze them and then cook about four or five for a day or two. And after I was done baking, I'm like, I just don't have eating an actual baked cookie after licking spoons and fingers and all that stuff. I just didn't do it. I'm like, this is very strange. Something is wrong with me. I'm like, why am I not happy? I went to all this effort and now I'm going to have cookies, what, tomorrow? So that is the only thing that's changed in my life prior to my battling the sugar tooth fiend that lives in me. That's interesting.
You know, there are people that, there's lots of people now that given us feedback, on how they feel, and really great because we try and speak with as many customers and people who started using it as we can. And yeah, I'd say about half the people, come back and say there are effects that they feel quite quickly. And it could be very almost unrelated to the brain specifically, like a lot more energy, or it could be very specific with respect to less mental fatigue or the ability for greater attention and alertness for sustained amounts of time, so forth. And other people have some very actually clinically almost interesting and very interesting from a research perspective, responses based upon their backgrounds. Because some people who have had cancer, and they had chemotherapy, actually, it's well known that it actually affects your cognition because it's obviously chemotherapy is toxic to some degree, right? So it has effects on the brain. And so, people start eating back to us on that based upon their experience with Relevé. And then there's a whole nother group. And to me, when I think about people who have immediate effects, I think that maybe out of, one out of the 17 or a few, or maybe all, I don't know, maybe they were profoundly deficient in one, two, three, or many of those. And all of a sudden they're being repleted. And so they're feeling the effects almost immediately, right? And then there are people, the other people who say, I don't feel anything immediately, but they say, I'm in it for the long haul. So that they understand that the brain health and preventive health and diet and nutrition in general is a long-term effort. And they go into it from that perspective and say, okay, I'm going to just do that. And I'm kind of like one of those people, right? I just know that this makes sense, So there's a lot of different experiences out there. And I think yours is actually, we're going to have to catalog that one. I mean,
yeah, just because
reduce sugar cravings, that'll be one that I have to put in.
Well, yeah, and I haven't mentioned this in a long time, but my maternal grandfather. So when I tell people that my sugar tooth is hereditary, this is proof right here. My maternal grandfather did not feel that a meal was finished until they had dessert. And so they would have, this is definitely horrible. They would have little packaged, processed sweet snacks after lunch and after dinner every day. Now, I don't know that he had dessert after breakfast. That would be my idea of heaven, but that's okay. I have berries almost every day, so those are nice and sweet, and that helps a lot too. But, my mom ate, she had terrible teeth. She had like really soft teeth, and she would eat this sticky candy and she'd break teeth all the time. And she could literally eat hard candies or taffies or sugar daddies or whatever, just all those crazy sticky things, and still maintain like a healthy body weight. She probably didn't have it, probably physically inside was not as healthy, but she looked, she never had to lose 100 pounds like I did. That came from my dad's side of the family. So I'm hoping, I got the sugar tooth from my mom's side of the family and the fat gene from my dad's side of the family. I hope I got the longevity from both sides and the non-Alzheimer's from dad's side. Like when you talk about genetics, it's just really fascinating. But I mean, it's taken years to learn to like tame the sweet tooth. I have to actively until recently, and I've noticed this because just like two dark Hershey's kisses and I'm fine. It's like, and just for reference, 7 Hershey kisses is a serving. So I'm not even getting like half a serving. Like 2 is enough. Which has never been the case. I just have made it be enough because I know And it's a lot of sugar. It's a lot of fat. And I don't need that stuff, yeah. except that I do because I get nasty if I don't have chocolate again.
Yeah, that's so important, though. Yeah, it's really great that you have it under control, because metabolic and pre-diabetes or diabetes is just such a huge risk factor for dementia and neurodegenerative disease. It is, you know, once you start losing, creating insulin resistance in our bodies, it creates a lot of problems in the brain. And so insulin resistance isn't just like a weight thing, right? It's definitely right. affecting the brain heavily because the brain is so energy intensive. I mean, just sitting still here, it's going to burn, it's 2 or 3% of our weight, but it's going to burn 25-ish% of the energy that we spend each day. So it's punching way higher than its weight, I guess you can say, from an energy usage perspective. So the brain loves glucose, right? The brain loves other energy sources. You know, when we start to mess with that, and start to interfere with that through insulin resistance or other types of, you know, metabolic issues, it's for sure going to affect the brain. So, and I got to watch it too, because I kind of like you, I've been trying, you've probably done a better job. I'm trying to ratchet back, you know, like just, I always have like some chocolate chips laying around and things like that, you know, with my coffee in the morning, you know, stuff like that. And then my wife comes from a family where dessert was very common also. So just super common. Like dessert was like, you know, this is like the thing, you know, after dinner. And I never really had that in my family. But then I got married and all of a sudden dessert's becoming this thing, right? So we're trying to ratchet that back now down too. So it's,
well, two things. Dark, like the dark Hershey Kisses, if you eat one and like actually pay attention to eating it, like let it melt in your mouth. Because you got the dark chocolate, which has got a little bit of benefits. So have two of those and then drink some water. Usually you can like, and then do something, get busy doing something else so that your brain is not focused on, ooh, let's have more of that. You can generally take about a third of the sugar out of baked goods before you mess up the chemistry of the recipe. So those are a couple of things. I don't generally take out that much sugar, but if it says like a cup, I will do like a scant cup. So I've taken out maybe 10%.
Yeah.
The silken tofu takes out a lot of the butter or the, you know, the garbagey fat that we don't need. And it adds in protein. So you have a couple of these cookies that are warm from the air fryer, which gives it I don't want to say restaurant, but like cookie shop baked.
Yeah.
What is that place called? Bakery style feel of the cookie. And literally because they, and I use whole wheat flour, like white whole wheat flour, they're filling. If you have a third one, you almost feel a little wet. Like, ooh, that was just one too many cookies. So two is generally plenty the way I cook them. And then what was the other trick that I
I don't know. I don't know how my kids are able to eat so much. You know, when they get their hands on sweets, they can just like gobble it down. I look at them and I'm like, okay, just, you're going to make me throw up just watching you. Just stop.
Well, yeah, our bodies can put up with a lot of crap when we're younger. You know, like, I've never been a drinker. I'm solar powered, sun up, I'm awake, sun down, I'm asleep. I've never pulled an all-nighter because that just doesn't work for my brain. And it's just, I don't drink, I don't do any of that stuff. But I've read where, you know, like, our bodies can, you know, in our 20s, you know, we stay up all night drinking and we can go to work on Monday and be reasonably fine. I wouldn't be, but that's me. And, you know, but as in your 30s now, not so easy. And as we get later in life, it's just like our body just can't get rid of that crap. It cannot recuperate as fast as it does when we're 10 or 20 or whatever. But what I did to lose all the weight and to retrain my brain was to start taking out the fats and the sugars and replacing we didn't eat a lot of white starchy carbs, but replacing those with better starchy carbs. Slowly, my personal trainer said, don't make all these changes at once because your body will revolt, which I totally agree with. And that's the smartest thing. Make changes slowly so that they just become a habit.
So they stick. Yeah.
Yeah. And then I was going to say, the other thing that we have, you said to use a lot of olive oil. We also grow that here. Yeah. So I get organic, fresh from locally sourced olive oil. And we do
that's
buy it.
Great. That's great. Using it as your primary oil for culinary purposes is like the way to go. That's just a wonderful oil, like avocado as well. And it's one of those things where you can have a lot of it. It's not the same as butter. It's not the same as any saturated fats. So these are monounsaturated fatty acids, which are very healthy for the brain. And they also help absorb, bring food and bring in some of these other nutrients like the vitamin E's, luteins, zeaxanthin, whatever it might be, that are very helpful for the brain as well. So they help you absorb food as well. So having that is really healthy. And just want to make sure people just really, you know, understand or are reminded, you know, of all these things that we should be doing, you know, to protect our brain health. But I just want to make sure that, and you, I was listening to one of your other podcasts earlier, and you go way deeper. It's like there's an EFT episode where you're talking about emotional freedom techniques. I was actually really trying to tap myself in a meridian somewhere in my body to try and relax myself before this podcast, so I wouldn't, you know, be too nervous or anything. But there's exercise, there's nutrition, of course, which we've spoken about a lot. There's exercise, which is extremely important. It could be just as important as nutrition, right? And the reason why we talk about nutrition and exercise so much when it comes to brain health is because they're actually easy to study. So that's why scientists and, you know, people are, you know, it's easy to measure them. It's easy to see, you know, even though it's kind of hard to measure sometimes, but it's a lot easier to measure than how well have you cognitively trained yourself today, you know?
Yeah, that's
true. It's a lot easier to measure than how many social connections did you make today, which are other things as well. Staying socially connected, you know, cognitive training, keeping those comorbidities in check, like cardiovascular and metabolic health, you know, and finally sleep, like you mentioned, that's something we can measure too. And there's a lot more studies going on there too, right? Sleep, because obviously during the sleeping hours, that's when a person's brain is basically all the waste is taken out. And if you don't do that, then the waste builds up. So shorter and shorter amounts of sleep we get, the less and less, the more the waste and debris builds up in our brains.
You know, and it doesn't file the memories very well.
That's right. There's also memory formation, long-term memory formation happening during sleep as well. So there's so many things that happen. I used to always just think, well, sleep is just for rest so I can function. And yeah, there's like so many deeper things going on during sleep. So
yeah, sleep is interesting. And if I get a really crappy night's sleep, you were talking about how the brain basically punches above its weight class in energy usage. If I get a really short, just interrupted poor night of sleep, one, doesn't even have to be more than one, God forbid it's two, I will wake up and my brain will be like, yo, let's have some pastries for breakfast. Now, how about a donut? Yeah, donut sounds really good. It's like literally the sugar fiend goes berserk. And I know it's because my brain thinks if I get some pastries and some tea with the caffeine, then I'll be all fueled up. Yeah, and then you're going to crash and burn in an hour, but, you know, whatever. Then it'll just want more sugar. But I just find it really interesting because you wake up and you're like, dang, you know, whatever. This past weekend, the neighbors had a birthday party for his wife, and they warned us in advance that there was going to be a DJ. And thank goodness he was playing some really good tunes because they went past 11 o'clock, and I could hear them. And it was like, okay, I was really enjoying your music, but now I'd really like to have some sleep. I'm just fascinated that the brain immediately goes to sugar. It's like not let's have a nice hard-boiled egg and some berries to supplement this crappy night's sleep. No, it just wants a pastry donut, and it's almost like my brain is screaming at me to just like pour in garbage sugar, you know, white flour, fat, just all the garbage
it's
we don't need.
It's in like a survival mode, basically, right? It's like, just give me what I can, you know, to keep going. And so it's like the brain is made for two things, right? It's for survival and for thriving, right? You know, for a person. And I think the survival was kicking in there, you know, after a bad night's sleep.
Yeah, God, I hate that. Because when we first moved into this house, there were no blinds. We had to put blinds on the windows. And so all of the light pollution was filtering in. And the old house, the bedroom faced open space. So there was phenomenally less light pollution. And after like, I don't know, 2 or 3 weeks, basically threatened to murder my husband if he didn't get blinds. So I'm like, dude, I'm not getting enough sleep. I'm waking up every day and my brain is screaming for a donut. Like, we got to stop this. So we fixed that problem, which is good because not feeding my brain a donut for breakfast, because I'm not even sure I'd get through my workout if I ate like that. It would not. My mouth says, ooh, a donut, because I must be hungry. But my mouth's like, ooh, a donut sounds good. Like, no, you're going to get lunch, and it's going to be a healthy lunch.
when I was in high school and I used to swim, you know, used to get donuts right after the morning workouts. And I just think to myself, wow, we used to go to Winchell's Donuts. And I don't know if Winchell's is even around still, you know, but like, sheesh, 12 pack of Winchell's Donuts right after swimming. I mean, that's probably not the best way to recover, but you know, like you said, we were young, we could recover very easily. So
yeah, your body got what it needed out of that. Not everything, you know? And so that's, I think that's what happens. It's like, you know, when we're young, we can eat garbage and run around. And I was on swim team too. And I made the mistake of giving that up for band. Wrong choice, but that was okay. That was 40 years ago. Jeez Louise. Actually, I think it might've been 41 years ago, but it's okay. I used to eat breakfast, ride my bike to the pool, which was probably between a mile and a half, and swim for at least an hour. I can't remember if our practices were an hour, hour and a half. And then I would ride home and have second breakfast. So I trained myself to like basically have the equivalent of four meals. So when I gave up swimming, my body didn't particularly want to give up four meals a day. Oopsies. And we didn't burn off nearly as many calories in marching band as we did in swim team. So,
and not that much marching.
Yeah, no.
Marching didn't quite compensate.
No, that would have to be like sprinting band, which would be really hard to play. So, yeah, like I said, it was the wrong choice. The band practice competed, and the coach on the swim team violated his own rules, and it made me angry, and I was just a stupid teenager. So I'm like, whatever, I'm just going to do marching band. And like I said, wrong choice. But, you know, now I walk dogs. I do all kinds of physical exercise. Let's see, I eat everything on the MIND diet except for the fish and the red wine. So I think I'm doing okay. Mm-hmm. But I'm going to do that. Yeah. I'm going to go to the healthybrains.org and see where I land. Maybe I'll do that.
Yeah, I got to plug healthybrains.org. It's a good website. It's, you know, with the Cleveland Clinic, we have a couple of medical advisors from there. So, you know, it's a great resource for people to just get a feel for where they're at with a number, a score, if you will, for their brain health, how they're maintaining and just kind of protecting their brains, you know, over the long run. Because I think the big thing that people need to understand is there are things that they can do, even if you are genetically predispositioned to develop a neurodegenerative disease in the future. That, like, for instance, the most common and risk factor genetically for Alzheimer's is the APOE4 gene, right? And if you have one allele of it, or if you carry two alleles, that increases your risk by quite a bit. So if you carry one allele of it, then it's like 3x increase in risk. If you carry two, it could be as much as 12x increase in risk. But that gene is malleable. It's pliable. You can bend it. You can affect its long-term, you know, its long-term effects by adopting a lot of these different strategies that we talked about. So don't just give up if, you know, for some reason you got a test, maybe 23andMe, I don't know what, and you found out you have the APOE4 gene. It's okay. It means, sure, you have to work harder. You would need maybe more of these healthy fats, especially if you have APOE4, because it's a fat transport defect. I shouldn't say a defect. It's a fat transport variation, because this is not a defect, right? This is common in about 20-25% of people out there, right? So it's not like this weird genetic mutation or anything. It's just the way we are as people. It's just one of the ways we are, you know? So you can do things about it. That's really important. No. I wanted to hit on the genetics part, because I know some people don't want to find out, right? And that's fine. Because if you're going to do everything anyway to protect your brain health, then why, you know, you're going to cover all the bases anyway. Some people do want to find out, and if they do, they shouldn't completely become, you know, just have a lot of despair, you know, out of it, you know, if they do find out that they have that sort of a gene. So,
well, doing all of this stuff we've discussed and taking product, you know, supplements like Relevate, if you have both genes, which, like you said, is 12x risk factor, mm-hmm. which is like, ugh, that gives me
it's
the creeps.
Steep, thinking. Yeah,
so that's not really a very comforting number. If you even delay 1 year of symptoms, you know, you may outlive your life expectancy. You might die before you get to the really ugly symptoms, the later stages of Alzheimer's that are really, really not fun to live through for anybody. Yeah. So that's kind of been my goal. Once I realized I did all of this healthy stuff to avoid becoming diabetic, because my dad was, he'd been on dialysis and he had a kidney transplant and still didn't take very good care of his kidneys. And he basically died from kidney failure because he didn't want to go back on dialysis. Mm-hmm. Anybody that's never experienced that, dialysis is not a way to live. It's just a way to stay alive. So I was like, yeah, let's take care of that problem before it happens. Because, again, I like sugar and I didn't want to do dialysis. So that I went through all of that to avoid that. And then I learned how much it benefited my brain. And then our very first Rotary convention, it was one of those breakout sessions for people who haven't gone to conventions. You know, it's the little side meetings. And it was peace and brain health. And I thought, what the heck kind of topic is that? But it's brain health, so I'll go listen to it. And essentially, they were talking about the tsunami of neurocognitive diseases and the impact it will have on the globe, which is definitely, we kind of went through that last year, so we kind of got a precursor of what it could be. And they talked about, you know, if we can delay the onset of symptoms for 1 year, it saves this many trillions of dollars. And if we can put it off 5 years, it saves, like, I don't know, numbers of dollars I can't even fathom.
Yeah.
And, you know, if I go backwards in time with my mom 5 years, 5 years prior to her death, she was okay. She wasn't super easy to deal with, but she wasn't like she was the last couple of years. So it's like, you know, if we could have pushed how she was at 72 into later 70s before she died, you know, it just would have benefited everybody. So that's my goal, is to do everything I can to stay healthy. And once you get into an exercise routine, it's really hard. Your body doesn't like it when you stop. So
I know, it's the other addiction, right? All those like endorphins and stuff that get released. It's like, I want more.
Yeah. And those are good. Like, I was having kind of a, not such a hot mood this morning. And then I did a great Peloton class and I knew I was going to have like nice conversation with you. And it's like, look, my mood is 100% better. That's the power of exercise that I really love. And I do, I'm going to throw out what my trainer taught me a long time ago. Cannot exercise off bad eating. She's right. Sucks. Like, you eat too much pizza, hamburger, french fries, and beer. I don't drink beer either, but my husband did. You can exercise all day. You're not going to get rid of that garbagey diet. So your body is, it needs to move and think and be fed properly. And so it's a lot to maintain, but it's worth it.
Yeah. And so that's another thing. Yeah. The things to avoid, you know, but processed meats, red meat, sugars, sweets, you know, any of that, that's really low in nutrients and very high in some very bad things that could send you down the diabetic path or something along those lines. So,
I don't want that. I don't want Alzheimer's. So I'm going to keep exercising, going to keep eating right, going to keep taking my Relevate, going to keep challenging my brain to learn new things. Did I miss anything? Sleep good.
No, there we go. I know a lot of people listening to this, they know very well what the stakes are. There's a lot of other people that don't think about brain health as much and we don't realize how much it, you know, really are all of our meaning in life really comes from relationships that we have with people, just interacting with people like you and me talking right now, exchanging ideas or talking about our stories to each other, you know, and that's everybody, it's all about relationships and our brain stores and enables us to engage in that, you know? So once we start to lose that, then that's huge, you know, when it comes to our, you know, the purpose for our lives and being able to achieve the purposes for our lives, you know? So just being able to think and learn and remember and create and especially to love, right? To people. That's just, that is what our brain is right in the middle of. So, you know, I know that a lot of caregivers, you know, I saw it with my mom, especially. I mean, there's just so little time to take care of themselves, you know, and caregivers are at such high risk of cognitive decline, you know?
Yep.
You know, because of lack of sleep, exhaustion, obviously depression that comes along with it, you know, those are all risk factors, right? That feed in. And so just the little things that could be done, to help move a little bit closer to a brain healthy diet or a brain healthy lifestyle. Just little things. That's great. You know, we shouldn't poo poo that. It's a big monumental shift for a lot of people. If they could even make the little things, like you said, like the 10 minute Peloton, just mega high intensity interventional training. So probably some person screaming at you through that screen.
I avoid that guy, but generally the HIIT classes are a lot of jumping, and I got crappy knees from being overweight for years. And I fell twice, once on each knee. So, unfortunately, right now I live in a two-story house, which I don't like because my knees complain all the way up the stairs. And they have for 20 years. They've been grumpy for 20 years. So, again, that's another reason to worry about keep taking off the extra weight that's crept on the last 4 years. But it is amazing. You know, in 10 minutes, you think, you know, I'm not going to burn very many calories. What can I do in 10 minutes? Trust me, these 10-minute HIIT classes... They like totally hit you in the face. Yeah, there was one morning I was running behind and I had a recording like we're doing now. And I'm like, I know I'm going to regret it if I don't do something. I'm like, let me just go see what the options are. And there's like, I don't know, thousands of options. And it was like, oh, 10-minute HIIT class. I have time for that. And trust me, I was really glad I didn't pick the 20-minute one.
Would have been the same intensity, just double the time, I bet.
Yeah, right? Exactly. And our Peloton is upstairs. So, you know, if I'm jumping up and down, it's kind of like, it's a little much. So, you know, there are options. And once you learn what some of the options are, you're like, oh, okay. Like I have a past guest, he used to walk with his wife. And then he used to walk when the caregivers were at their house. And it's a good and bad thing. But it got to the point where he couldn't really leave her. So he would just walk around the house, called it house walking, which, okay, is definitely better than not. I would have liked to have seen him get outside because, you know, the sunshine is good for us as long as we don't get burnt. My fans know that I am like super pale. And we've, trying to think, we talked about vitamin D with Dr. Elena recently. And I don't know if that's this week's episode or not. Doesn't matter. You guys all hear it.
Really important. Yeah.
Yeah. And I actually, before I go on a bike ride, will look at the UV index, where it's at right now. I have sunscreen in my bike bag, and I will go out of the house, blonde, pale chick, and ride for between 30 and 60 minutes. Mm-hmm. Like, depends on the UV index. And then we'll take a water stop and I will apply sunscreen. And as long as I time it right, I get plenty of vitamin D and no sunburn.
Absolutely.
So it's, you know, there's just a lot of things we can do that don't take a lot of time once we're aware of them. And that's why I like to have conversations like this because, you know, like I told you before, if I had to gag down fish to avoid Alzheimer's, I would probably try it, but I would not be happy about it. And I don't drink wine, but everything else is good. So I'm like, okay, I'm at about 80%. So if Relevate can fill in that 20%, that's huge. You know, even if it's only doing 10, or if I'm overestimating my 80%, you know, like I'm not great at math. So, you know, but take it for what it's worth. You know, I do that. I exercise, I sleep right. And I'm reminding myself that I need to wear my Apple Watch to bed and measure sleep again. Like trying to do that like once a month. All of these little things will add up. I know they will. Yeah. Doctors might disagree or there might be other evidence that says, you know, they may or they may not. I know they'll add up. And so I'm just going to keep doing it. And I think I got to get my husband on Relevate now because having the realization, there we go, that my sugar cravings went down once I started taking Relevate. You know, let me know if you need me to put that someplace in writing because I find that very, It's the only thing that's
wonderful. Changed. It's one of those things. You just never know. But that's a good thing. That's a good thing.
Yeah, and you know, I'm not sorry that the sugar monster has been turned off, mostly.
Mm-hmm. Thanks for having me on, you know. I really appreciate it. And what you're doing for the community, because there are so many people who just want to hear practical things about caregiving you know, about brain health, things like that. So, you know, I'm glad you quit photography and you went into this. So
Well, I did both for a while, but the pandemic, it just, you know, and moving, it was like, there's just a lot of reasons. I'm like, you know what? I'm just going to focus on the podcast and I enjoy it.
Yeah.
And
I make it really easy too.
Well, I mean, yeah, it's like I've been using Zoom since September of 2018. So once we had the pandemic, all of my older guests that are in their 70s and 80s that are tech klutzes, is a term one of them used when we were having an issue with her Zoom. I don't have those problems anymore. So that was a plus from the pandemic.
Yeah, totally.
And I like podcasts where it's just conversational. I don't like want the ones where I have a list of questions and I want to fire at you. And I find those are more, they're easier to listen to. So I just made a podcast like I would want to listen to, and more people are finding me and agreeing. So that makes me feel good.
That's great. That's great. Yeah, I was kind of getting ready for this. Like, you know, the questions, like boom, 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 boom. I was like, okay, getting ready. But then
you know, I probably should do a little bit more of that sometimes. But I feel like we covered all the reasons why you created Relevate, why we should take it, you know, why we need to be concerned with, you know, properly fueling our brains. Because, you know, until somebody explains it, we might say, yeah, I know I should eat better, but once you know what the but, what comes after, but yeah, I should eat better, but it's a pain in the, you know, it's hard. It takes a lot of time. I don't have time. But if I don't, I'm putting myself at risk for having the same disease that I'm taking care of right now with my mom or my grandmother or my spouse.
Yeah.
So that's just how I roll. I try to keep it real easy.
Yeah. That's
well,
great.
This has been great. And I know Ed and I are probably ready for lunch now.
I know. You know what? That's right. Circling back around again.
Yeah, back to the food topic. Yeah.
All right. Now we'll try and control ourselves when we go down. When I go downstairs, I'll try and control myself.
That's yes, please do. Make sure you have your all your proper foods and make sure you take your Relevate so that your cravings go down.
Absolutely.
All righty.
Well, thanks so much, Jen.
Fading Memories is also available wherever you get your favorite podcasts.